Okay, cool. We'll get started. I want to thank everyone for taking time out of their day to be here this evening. This is the Functional Health Forum, and my name is Aaron Howard. I'm the organizer of this forum. That's my brother up there, number 77. He's a tackle for the Raiders, and I'll explain more about this later. But a little bit about me. I have a bachelor's degree in health and human performance from Iowa State University. I also am a current nursing student at Black Hawk University. I'm a certified medical nurse assistant. I also am a certified yoga instructor, and I teach at Soul Hot Yoga in Davenport, Iowa. I am a representative and regional director of M Today Nutrition and Skin Nutrition, and just recently joined the Mandela family as the health coach and weight loss manager of a lifestyle program that we're putting together this summer. And a little bit about that program, I'm really excited about it because when we're talking about weight loss, you know, there's a lot of programs out there that kind of are cookie cutter programs where they might focus on just, you know, a particular diet or maybe a particular exercise. But this program, we're going to go way beyond that. We're going to take into account a lot of the things that are that you deal with as far as in your lifestyle to help you control and help you manage your weight, if that's a problem for you. So I'm really excited for this program to start off. We're going to be discussing a little bit more about this on June 1st at Mandela Integrative Medicine on 53rd Street. So if you have any questions, there's a number there. You can call the office. Dr. Shaw's here, and I'm here as well to answer any questions after the forum tonight. But getting back to the forum, this is, again, the reason this is put together is to give exposure to the community about a new wave and movement of functional healthcare, which involves a variety of integrated practices that serve in the prevention and the treatment of disease and illness by addressing the underlying cause. And that's really significant. And again, that's why, you know, I'm passionate to stand here and be here today to learn more about autoimmune. You know, autoimmune disorders, they are definitely on the rise here currently. They've reached epidemic numbers now. And this picture here, again, that's my brother, but this is my mother and my sister. And they have both been diagnosed, my mother early on, with diabetes at the age of 30, type 1, which is an autoimmune disorder. She then developed lupus, and then Hashimoto's, and then Sjögren's. My sister is on the same path as well. And so that's kind of what drove me to be here today, to put together this forum, and to study more medicine, and to get involved into learning how I cannot allow autoimmune to define my mother and my sister and my family. And that's why I'm also happy to be here with Lisa, who is experiencing the same things as my family. So I'm really happy and excited to hear her story. But moving along, I'm gonna jump to Les Pritchard. Les is the CEO and president of Them Today, a local nutrition company. And when you talk about someone being a wealth of knowledge, this guy knows a handful when it comes to nutrition and functional medicine and integrative techniques to handle illness and chronic disease. So I'd like to bring to the platform Les Pritchard.
Thank you, Aaron, very much. Thank you, guys. It's a pleasure to be here. I love the phrase functional medicine. It's kind of a new buzzword in America. But we've been a little bit behind the eight ball. If I can take you back in history, in the last 100 years or so in America, it started in the 20s. There was a congressional report from the Department of Agriculture presented to both houses of Congress at the time showing that the vast majority of American soil was deficient in vitamin and minerals. Well, once we got through the Depression and World War II, what we saw was a huge vitamin business being born. Unfortunately, it was a synthetically based vitamin business designed just for that, for business and profit. Well, that's when everybody started taking their one-a-day vitamins, and later in the 80s, the fish oil research came out. And now, in 1988, C. Everett Koop was the Surgeon General. He, in a speech to both houses of Congress, stated that the vast majority, quote, vast majority, unquote, of American deaths were preventable and happening because of malnutrition. Well, do you think we're eating any better than we were in 1988, 2016, or are we eating worse? Is our food supply full more full now of synthetically, genetically modified foods? Absolutely. The answer is absolutely. The number of chemicals when I was a kid that the FDA legalized for food companies to put into the food supply was under 100. Now it's over 3,300 synthetically derived food. When you walk into the grocery store today, everything pretty much on the inside of the store is made out of corn and soy. And it's not just corn and soy, it's genetically modified corn and soy saturated in pesticides and herbicides. A recent study in the Chicago suburbs, 12 different municipalities tested positive for pharmaceuticals, cocaine, mercury, and different things in their tap water supply. So you're either in denial or you're living in a cave today if you don't realize that we are inundated with environmental toxins in the air, in our skincare, in our shampoos, in our food. And so in relation to functional medicine, in relation to autoimmune disease and chronic inflammation, which is one of the biggest beasts that you try to slay when you're dealing with any kind of chronic issue, is nutrition, the power of nutrition. What the needs of the human body cellularly haven't changed in thousands of years. What's changed nutrition is technology. We can now dehydrate kale and spinach and chlorella and spirulina and turmeric and some of the world's most powerful superfoods. I love turmeric. I put it in my body every day. There's over 1,500 studies that show that turmeric is an effective treatment for over 150 different types of cancer. So back to America, it's so great that we are starting to change. There is a wave. There is a tidal wave going around this country because it's our generation that has seen our parents die prematurely, and we look down at the next generation of the kids, and these are the first generation of kids that are predicted not to outlive their parents in the United States. That's what a grave issue this is. So I take my hat off to you for coming here on a Wednesday night to try to learn more about it. But what happens is, and it starts at an early age, but we start to, our immune system is pretty amazing if we can get out of the way. And we ought to understand that the body can reverse disease. Some people will fall on their excuse and say, you know what, breast cancer runs in my family. Diabetes runs in my family. And we sure can be genetically predisposed for different conditions. There's no doubt about it. But the genotypic versus phenotypic argument was solved when we studied the Okinawans, who had more centurions than any other population demographic in the world, and they emigrated to the United States, and for the first time in the history of those people, they developed American diseases that didn't exist in Okinawa. Lisa and I work with Dr. Karyuparthi, who's a great guy, a medical doctor, pain specialist in Rock Island. He studied colon cancer in medical school in India. They couldn't find a single case of it because of the high amounts of turmeric and curry in the Indian diet. They had to come to America to find a real case of colon cancer that we get more often than any other country in the world because of our diet. It's now the third leading cause of fatal cancers in this country. So what happens is our immune system gets overwhelmed, right? We represent 13% of the world's population. We take 70% of the drugs. Penicillin used to kill 80, 90% of bacteria. Now it kills 28, 30%. These bugs have gotten sophisticated. They want to survive in the body. And our immune system is crazy amazing. I mean, if we took the first scientist in 1920 who looked at the human cell for the first time under a microscope, and we put all the things that we know now about how a cell works, his mind would explode. We have learned so much, and we're continuing to learn every single day, of how amazingly powerful the human body is. But the immune system can turn into our own worst enemy in relation to autoimmune disease and chronic disease. And the reality is that when I sprain my ankle, my body has an inflammatory response. And that's an acute inflammatory response designed to bring blood flow and protection and all these things that happen when you cut your finger. White blood cells and antibodies and all these things to fight infection, coagulate and stop the blood flow. All these things happen for a reason. But chronic inflammation is something different. When we flood our bodies full of foreign molecules from pharmaceutical drugs, from synthetically derived food, from synthetically derived nutrition, GNC, Walgreens, and Walmart all were shut down by the Attorney General in the state of Oregon and the state of New York for selling nutrition that had nothing on their label. Okay? I just got back from the manufacturing facility that makes this product, and I couldn't be more proud that you could eat off the floor. We were quarantined. We had to put suits on. It was the most amazingly pure product that we could find in regards to the purity of nutrition. So my point is, it pays to know where you're getting your nutrition. And if you're buying a bottle of fish oil for $4 at Walgreens like that, you're doing far more harm to your body than good. The World Health Organization partnered with the country of Finland in 2010. They studied fish oils, the top sellers. 97% of them were full of rancid fish oil, olive oil, soybean oil, and everything but a good, clean, pure omega-3 source of DHA and EPA, the two healing molecules that fight inflammation in the omega family. We get plenty of sixes and nines from our food supply. Those are not the omegas that we want. So back to the scenario here in the average American. We're inundating our body with fake foods. You remember the argument that said, don't breastfeed your babies, it's bad, use formula. It turned out to be a big lie, right? Remember the argument that says, don't use butter, it's bad for you, use margarine. That turned out to be a big lie. Now we're talking about a no-fat diet. If you guys are on a no-fat diet, I would urge you to get long-term care insurance so you're not a liability for somebody as you get into your 60s and 70s and 80s and they're not having to change your diaper, because your brain is all fat. And when you starve your body of fat, you're starving your brain. And we will see an epidemic of brain disease in this country in the next generation because of the great cholesterol hoax written by Sherry Tenpenny, a brilliant medical doctor. And we're stealing cholesterol and we're stealing the brain of the nutrition that it needs to survive. So we inundate the body with foreign molecules. This causes an inflammatory response. Well, eventually, our bodies don't know whether we should attack a virus or a bacteria. We don't know if we should attack the synthetically derived sugars and sucralose and aspartames that are coming into our body. Okay, those things should never be legal. They're highly toxic and to our neurological systems. But because of business, they're legal. And we use them because they're cheap. And they make things taste sweet. But the body finally raises the white flag and says, I don't know if I should attack this tissue in the joint, rheumatoid arthritis, or if I should go after this bacteria. I don't know if I should have an inflammatory response because you just ate Krispy Kreme, or I don't know if I should go attack this bacteria or virus that's been hiding and brooding in your body. And that's the beginning of a very horrible cycle in the body. And at a cellular level, we do not accept nutrition unless it is organic, food-based, plant-based nutrition. When you look under a microscope and you see a healthy cell, it looks like there's a white light behind it. It's beautiful with its mobility and its sphere, and the cell wall is plump. When you look at a disease cell, it looks like corrugated cardboard. It's deathly looking. It's dim. Okay. When you see real nutrition come into the bloodstream in a live blood cell analysis format, and you put in a fresh juice into your body, or you put in 22 servings of fruits and vegetables into your body, and organic pea protein, and turmeric, and ginger, and spirulina, and chlorella, and some of the greatest superfoods we've ever known to fight disease, inflammation in the body. When you put those in the bloodstream and they come across a healthy cell, there is a chemical, biological attraction that sucks those two things together like a water and a sponge in the desert. A synthetically derived vitamin is just like synthetically derived food. There is no cellular resonance. There's no cellular acceptance. So I'm not here to sell you my nutrition today, although the next speaker you're going to hear from has benefited tremendously from it, and so has Lisa, and so has Aaron, and frankly, we have hundreds of testimonials of people who have, because they're putting good nutrition to alkalize their internal environment versus acidic, to putting good nutrition there to fight the chronic inflammation that they've been dealing with, and for maybe for the first time in their life, they're satisfying their cellular nutritional needs because we put over 50 different powerful molecules into that. And Al, when I first met Al, he says, well, what's it taste like? Well, I can't lie to Al. And so I told him it tastes like grass and it smells like hay. And it's true, because nutrition shouldn't taste like vanilla ice cream. And all too often we see that guys in the gym that buy that vanilla ice cream tasting whey isolated, chemically derived synthetic protein, they might as well be burning their money because they're causing far more harm in their body than good. So this is our foundational product that we launched. We're located in Bettendorf. My wife and I have been in the wellness industry for 22 years. Our journey started when she was misdiagnosed with multiple sclerosis. We had just opened up a massage therapy center and a chiropractic wellness center. And all the medical doctors in Chicago told her to find a different position. She was losing the use of her arms and hands, like a paresthesia type of sensation, which is like when your foot falls asleep. They said, well, find another profession, get out of massage. If you're losing the use of your arms, well, my wife's Italian, and you guys can be stubborn. So she felt like God slammed a door in her face, but a window opened to natural healing, and she has become a true healer and a certified health practitioner. Truth be told, I carry most of the heavy boxes, but she's the brains of the family, and I've learned an awful lot from her. But I saw her turn her life around with everything that I told you tonight, with real nutrition. The reality is that Lynette used to charge you a lot of money if you were willing, so she could come to your house and empty your pantry into a garbage bag and throw all your food out. Then she'd take you to the grocery store and teach you how to shop again. Then we'd go back to your kitchen. She'd teach you how to uncook and start eating raw whole foods, plant-based diet. And we saw improvement every single time. But the reality is, not everyone's going to do that. Not everyone's going to change their diet. What about the rest of Americans that like their Bud Light, their chicken wings, and their football on Sundays? Well, I'm one of those guys. I used to be a really pure vegan type eater, but you know, you have a teenager and things fall apart. But I feel pretty good that I leave the house by 7 a.m. She understood that. I feel pretty good. By the time I leave my house, I put 22 grams of pure organic pea protein, plus all those antioxidants, plus a mushroom blend to boost my macrophage killer T cells and my immune fighting cells, and all these things into my body, so I leave knowing I hit my nutritional needs. I had a cellular acceptance of my nutrition first thing in the morning, and I broke my fast. You know, the word breakfast stands for breaking a fast. If you split your 24-hour day into 3 8-hour periods, you slept eight, hopefully close to eight. Not always do we get eight, but you're breaking a fast. That's why they call it breakfast. The best thing to put in your body the first thing in the morning are greens. Why doesn't arthritis exist in nature when animals eat grass? Because grass breaks up the calcium and all the hardening of the joints. We get arthritis because of our diet here, and that's just one example. So I could go on and on. The other thing that we did, guys, is we came out with a core nutritional package. This is a very unique product that we developed, the Royal Flush. Colon cancer, we talked about it. This is a gentle, natural, made up of okra, two types of aloe vera, fig, prunes, real food. We dehydrate it, put it in a vegetable capsule, and you take it, and tomorrow you'll be unbelievably happy and thrilled what comes out of you. It just helps people get moving and get moving in the right direction. So this is non-habit forming, strengthens the peristaltic environment inside the colon, and Lynette's a colon hydrotherapist and digestive expert, so that's a product we developed. These are also unique to us because of the quality. Our fish oil comes from Finland. It's sourced from mackerel and sardines, little fish, not big tunas that can live years and collect tons of mercury. We beat the industry standards for purity by four times with that fish oil product, and a liquid D3. 80% of Americans and 100% of people with autoimmune diseases are deficient in vitamin D3. One of the most powerful things that you can put in your body, one of the simplest things that you can add. You don't get it from your food unless you're drinking cod liver oil every day, guys. You're not getting D3, not at a therapeutic level. We do make it when we sweat in the sun, but I haven't done that since last August. Just starting to get my sweat glands going again now since we hit 80. So that's just a little bit about general nutrition and what to watch out for. If you can find anything this good, I would jump on it. But be careful of what you're spending your hard-earned money on when it comes to nutrition, because there's a lot of nonsense out there. But the reality is that good, pure nutrition into the bloodstream that the cells can accept makes a positive difference in everybody's life every single time. It's just a matter of scientific fact. So with that, I'm pleased to introduce our next speaker. And I've got to go coach a high school soccer game. I volunteered this year, and my guys are going for a state a run. So I have to run out of here. I'd love to stay because there's some fantastic speakers coming up. You guys are going to learn a lot. And I would as well if I stayed, but I've got to run to see how those guys are doing. I want to introduce our next speaker, Lisa Strode. I've known Lisa for a couple of years now, and she's like a sponge when it comes to nutrition and wellness. I'll let her tell some of her own story, but she's also a wealth of knowledge, and it's been a pleasure, and thank you guys very much for having me. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Lisa Strodon. I'm nutrition coordinator with Live Fit with Lupus. I'd like to go over some of our upcoming events. On June 12th, we have our gluten-free cooking class, and the dishes can be ordered at our website, livefitwithlupus.org. It's at 6 p.m. at the Hy-Vee on Devil's Glen. Our next healing meeting will be June 27th at our building on Maple Crest, and Jim Perry of District Drugs will be speaking. But I would like to tell you about my journey with autoimmune disease and how I discovered functional medicine. You see, I had chronic migraines for decades. I was diagnosed with celiac disease and Hashimoto's thyroiditis in 2001. But I didn't know much about functional medicine, and I had a neurologist that suggested that I try yoga and meditation to reduce stress. And so I did, and I got some relief. And so I was getting a hint of incorporating functional medicine, but I didn't understand the overall value of added healing treatments, except for taking a pill and getting more rest. And I didn't understand the mind and body and soul connection. So I started incorporating yoga, massage, exercise, and counseling on my own, and I felt less stressed. Felt being the key word, not had less stress. And I started a gluten-free diet when I was diagnosed with celiac disease, but I didn't understand autoimmune disease and its effects on the body until I became involved with Live Fit with Lupus. I understood the textbook definition of autoimmune disease, but I didn't see all that it involves. And so my trek into functional medicine began with Jim Perry with District Drugs. We were talking about compounding medicine, and he suggested that I see Dr. Paul Bulger. And so Dr. Bulger put me on naturally desiccated thyroid. And so I went from almost 20 years of taking Synthroid to NDT, and I felt better. And then he suggested I see Dr. Ansu. So I saw Dr. Ansu for a year, and then my insurance got switched, and so then I started seeing Dr. Shah. And I also went through the program at Elite Health. And it's amazing to me that so many people, especially in this area, are treating with additional healing modalities. I was once told by a doctor, "You are a difficult patient." What? I'm a difficult patient? No, you're not a difficult person, you're a difficult patient. We can't figure out how to treat you. Doctors don't want to see difficult patients. We can't just open up a book and figure and find out how to treat you. So the difference between traditional medicine and functional medicine is that functional medicine addresses the underlying causes of your pain and offers you additional treatments, but traditional medicine just looks for an answer in a book. And so I still remain positive about my journey of healing. And how can I remain positive when I have a chronic disease that flares and is unpredictable? I took control of it with a gluten-free diet, supplements, exercise, and medication. But it's not smooth sailing. Like the old Johnny Mercer song, I learned from that song that you need to accentuate the positive and eliminate the negative in situations. On May 15th, 1982, my parents and my brother and sister were in a head-on collision car accident. They survived, but they still have health problems from that accident. I learned that life can end at any moment. And the loneliest time of my life were the hours in between finding out that they were in the accident and not knowing anymore, and then finding out that they were alive, but I didn't know what condition they were in. So I started making a list of, if they died, who I was going to go live with, where I was going to go to school, etc. I was 14 years old. And so at that point, I decided to look at life in a positive way, that every cloud has a silver lining, even those dark clouds in life. And there may not be a positive aspect of those situations, but I can learn something from it. And I heard people tell me, "You positive people make me sick." You know, how can you be so positive? things can always be better. Well, of course things can always be better. We're human. We're imperfect. Our situations and actions aren't perfect. So, and what's perfect for you might not be perfect for another. And so, it's all about interpretation and perspective. We know two things in life. Things can always be better. Things can always be worse. And it's the way you look at it. That is your choice. That's when you take your power back from the negative situation instead of letting it suck power from you. How you see your health makes a difference. And it starts by making one choice. Thank you.
For coming up and sharing her story. That was really interesting and very touching as well. But Lisa Eblith is next on the platform. And Lisa also has an inspiring and positive story about her situation and her experience tackling lupus. And so she's the CEO of Lift It for Lupus. She's doing wonderful things in the community. So it's my pleasure to bring to the platform Lisa Eblith.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And thanks for having us. And thank you, Lisa. That was great. Nice to hear it. I mean, I know Lisa, and she works closely with me. In fact, she's kind of more of the whole overall wellness coordination. And I appreciate everything she does for us, volunteering her time. And she's wonderful. So, and I know she has some struggles, and so it's tough. And so we have a lot in common. In fact, you know, I've also had quite the struggles throughout my life. It has been a tough road, I have to say, but I am really thrilled today that I'm able to do and accomplish many of my goals that I didn't think I would be able to do. It's been crazy, crazy life. I did have to dedicate all I could to my disease, learning, educating myself so that I was able to, you know, succeed. I was diagnosed with lupus in 1993. There was some crazy things before that happening as well. I had a splenectomy and an exploratory search surgery in 1987, just trying to figure out. I had my platelets weren't clotting, and so my blood wasn't clotting. I'd have bloody nose that would last for hours. I'd have, you know, bruises all over my body, very fatigued, thinking that it was leukemia at the time. And they diagnosed me with idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura, which ITP is an easier form to say. And so it was a challenge. It was very life-threatening at the time. And once we did the splenectomy, exploratory search surgery, after about a year of steroid therapy, things seemed to calm down quite a bit. As I went into college, things got a little bit tougher, and symptoms really did start to arise. But you know, growing up, I was always very extremely active. We were always at the ball fields. I pitched several games in a row. Like we would pitch, I mean, I could pitch probably in a, you know, some type of 21 days. Sorry, is this, can you hear me okay, or is it in my way? Or 21 games in a row I would pitch and just go on and on and on. And I was kind of considered like an Energizer Bunny, where I would just go around and jump around to different fields, different weekends. We would be out there, and my father coached my team, my mother coached my sister's team, and it was really fun. It was a fun time growing up. So I've always really had a fighter spirit. I've always been that person with the positive spirit as well. And but I did get tested, you know, over the years, definitely. I noticed when, after having splenectomy and the ITP, that it was, you know, I see back, you know, looking back, I guess that that was really the beginning of everything starting. When I was in college and I started to get, my hands were almost like they had been in a fire, so it really affected my skin. I had the butterfly molar rash. I had migraine headaches. I had numbness in my extremities, swollen joints. I had the mouth ulcers. I mean, my lips were completely bloody. It was making it really tough to eat. In fact, my hair was just kind of falling out all over. I remember getting ready in the morning and just seeing clumps of it by my next to my mirror, just from the disease itself. I tried to push through those symptoms, and it was really tough. Sometimes the pain was just so hard to even turn on the faucet to take a shower. And I can remember just walking on the edge of my feet down the hallway because it was just so painful. Just even getting out of bed was a struggle, such a challenge. When I did finally receive a diagnosis, it was kind of a relief. You know, it was something that you finally are labeled with something. You don't think something, you know, something has to be wrong with you. And so the label actually gave me that relief. But when I found out it was a chronic condition with no cure, that was a little tough to take. And it was, you know, I was so young. I had so many plans. And I was told that those plans would be changed, that, you know, I had to think of life differently. And I was kind of a fire, so I didn't want to think that way. I wanted to still do what I was, you know, supposed to do and accomplished. So I didn't give up. There were times, of course, you wanted to throw in the towel because it was tough. But I began educating myself all I could, just to reclaim my health back, and just about the disease process and learning about lupus, not only just lupus, but it really led me into all autoimmune diseases and the differences and the similarities as well. I remember reading in school, I went to the library to try to get information, and I read a book, you know, it was saying that I had 5 to 10 years to live, you know, from a diagnosis. And that kind of gives you a different perspective in life. And so I was kind of devastating with that. But I became so fascinated as to what was going on with my body. And I really wanted to reclaim my health. I was, you know, I wanted someone to tell me that they could cure me. And I was looking for that. I was looking for the cure-all. It didn't come easy. It was definitely a learning experience. And I had a hard time coping with that. I had a hard time coping with a label that I was slapped on. I mean, I was young, and nobody wants to deal with that. Nobody wants to just exist in life. And so I didn't tell many people about my lupus. I just kind of tried to hide it and isolated myself, which is not a good thing. And I realized that wasn't the right thing to do. It didn't get easier, and again, the acceptance was so tough. Each time I'd begin to heal, I would end up with a setback, you know, back in the hospital with either seizures or many strokes. My disease attacked my brain on several occasions. And when it's the brain, it's a lot different than just the swollen joints or the pain. The brain is precious. And when everything that makes you who you are feels like it's gone, it's a really tough situation to deal with, especially when you're super young and have so many plans. You know, I can remember in Iowa City, I spent a lot of time in Iowa City and in Mayo, and I'd have a team of doctors. I'd have a psychologist, a psychiatrist even, because a lot of the brain, I'd have a neurologist, of course, my rheumatologist, of course. I'd have even the kidney specialist at the time, nephrologist, and I'd have this team and people that were just enamored by what was going on because they didn't see a lot of CNS lupus. It's about 3% of the population, which is central nervous system involvement. And so they were just kind of enamored by what was going on with my condition. I hadn't seen something like that. And so I remember the doctors coming in, always asking me who the president of the United States was, you know, who, you know, what 100 minus 7 was, and then down from there. And those kind of things I could do. It was really just, you know, considered like dementia, where they would bring some objects into me, maybe that orange and a phone and a pen, and they take them away, and I'd have to remember what things were there set before me, and I couldn't, and I felt so stupid, and it was really tough. It was really tough to see everyone around me, my family watch me, and watch me suffer like that, struggle to find the words, and I was really good at spelling, and I couldn't even spell, I couldn't even write. It was really tough, and it was just depressing for me, feeling like my life was changed. My kidneys also were a tough one as well, one of the major organs that were also affected besides the brain. My weight dropped to like 72 pounds. That included my hospital gown and in the bed. They'd always weigh you in my bed because I couldn't really get up. And so my hair was totally gone by then, which didn't really matter to me at that point anymore. We did chemotherapy to try to reboot the immune system and kind of start over. So I did a lot of drug therapy throughout this time. That's all I knew. That's what you do. You go to the ER when you have a seizure, you go to the doctor, the medical doctors, you know, when there's trauma going on. And so that's what I knew. And, you know, I began to wonder at that point, you know, if life would ever be the same, if it would ever be tolerable, or if it would feel like a whole person again. I thought I'd never be able to take a walk, a simple walk, you know, instead of being pushed around in my wheelchair, let alone drive a car. Sometimes you may get frustrated with traffic or frustrated when you're having to get somewhere fast or you're just driving alone in your car. Well, next time you drive alone in your car, just think how special that is that you're able to do that. I mean, never take things for granted like that. I mean, to tie your shoe, to do the simple things in life are so special. And that's something that this taught me quite a bit. I mean, I'm always have been appreciative of life and positive about my spirit. It's, you know, I think I came out of the womb that way, but it's just important, those small things in life. You know, we don't sweat the small things, and we shouldn't, because there are many more things that, you know, could be tough to deal with. During that time frame, I have to say that things were tough, and even though I was positive about almost everything I still smiled, I still was thankful for being here each day. But I have to say there were times I didn't want to be here. I mean, I prayed to die. I prayed that it would, you know, I'd take the suffering and the pain away because I wanted, you know, a different life. It's kind of not what I planned on doing. But I knew that, you know, there was something in me. I can remember a certain time period when my cousin, she also had celiac and type 1 diabetes, very sick. We grew up sick together. And I remember her sitting on my bedside and telling me, you know, that basically that I needed to fight, not just for me, but for everyone around me, that I had plans, that there was, you know, there was more for me. And I can always remember her saying that, and it really gave me the picture of what it could be like for future. And so I decided, you know, that it was time to continue to fight and really try to reclaim my health and continue to survive, because that's what I was doing at the time. I was just existing. And I believe that, you know, we all need to find our purpose, because we all have one, and we need to find our plan. And maybe you don't know it at this point, but it will come to you. It's where your passion lies. And I think if we follow our passion in life, our purpose and our plan is set before us, and we see it. You know, follow your dreams and dream big. I believe in that. I do remember, I have to say this experience, it was very just profound when I got home from, you know, one of the bad flare-ups after hospital stay. My grandmother was living with us for a while because my mom had to work, and my mother and father are divorced, and my dad lives in El Paso, Texas. And so anyway, she would be with me daily, and we would do physical therapy. I had visiting nurses come, and it was just wonderful. You know, each baby step we took, like maybe we could just walk 10 feet the first day. The next day we walked, you know, 15 feet. Maybe the next day was a little backwards in the 7 feet, because when you start to heal, it's not always like a smooth sailing, as you get these bumps in the road. And I remember, though, finally with all the physical therapy, the occupational therapy, and again, that's when I really started getting into yoga at that point too. But all the meditation and everything I did to surround myself with good, positive things, I remember when I was able to drive, like for the very, very first time, and go to the grocery store. It was like amazing. And it was just something I can remember, like just clear as day. And it was such a special time for me to do that for myself and not have anyone right next to me always having to depend on someone else. So that independence was just so gratifying. So I worked really hard to manage my disease, and like I said, there was definitely a point where I didn't think I would get to where I am today. But continuing to set your goals high and fighting for what you want has gotten me to where I am today. I've been able to accomplish my plan. And today, like the disease that seemed like it would rob me of everything has actually given me a sense of purpose and determination. And I started this foundation called Live Fit with Lupus. And I'm just gonna kind of show you a little clip about what we do and I'll go from there. I might need Scott. Maybe not.
Yep, you got it. There you go. Click the little square in the bottom. Right there.
Can I turn it up?
No, where's the volume?
Area as a young child, and I've been living with lupus since I was diagnosed in 1993. I went to the Rheumatology Associates and into the infusion center and had my monthly routine today. So it took about an hour and a half, 2 hours from start to finish, and that helps with my manifestations of my lupus and calms things down. When I was first diagnosed with lupus, there was really nothing available for me as far as material on the subject matter. There was no support group for me to go to. I didn't know anyone that had lupus. I didn't know what lupus meant. And so it was a chronic condition. It was something that I was going to deal with for the rest of my life. In fact, I did find some old material listed that I had 5 to 10 years to live in the library at school. That was devastating. Today, life is much different. I am still living with lupus, but it doesn't define me. And I'm also a fitness competitor, which allows me to travel to different competitions, and I also model for different companies. And I thoroughly enjoy my job as a personal trainer, where I'm able to help others overcome their own obstacles. I think I've learned so much from dealing with my lupus and my own obstacles that I feel like there is no way to go but up, and I see things in a positive light. I want to help others and inspire others to overcome their obstacles as well. I know when someone is attacked, their immune system is attacked in any autoimmune disease or cancer or diabetes or in any way, you lose your identity. For me, and I've lost my hair on several occasions, and so for me that was part of my identity, and the way I looked, losing all the weight I lost, and I didn't feel beautiful anymore. And so I really wanted this foundation to be something that we could do to help others, you know, inspire others, inspire patients that not to give up, that they have hope. We've come a little ways. There's still some gaps in education materials, and we want to be that resource. We want to be the now what when you go to the doctor's office and you're given that pamphlet. You know, explanation of what your diagnosis is, and then from there, what do? You go home, you search the internet. There's so many questions that you have. We want to be those answers for those patients. So after, you know, connecting with the community and autoimmune patients, we started actually just kind of with an awareness event. We decided to do a race and a festival to let people know that we were here, let people know we were going to help them. We wanted patients to realize there's something out there for them. The race created a lot of awareness. Our first year was amazing, and it created awareness for people in the community. And it's been a great annual event for us as far as financially and being able to help patients. It's been a whirlwind for the last 2 years. In fact, just getting office space from Genesis Health Systems, it's been a wonderful thing for us. And the awareness events that we've created, from Zumba bonds to lifts to fashion shows to the race and festival and bowl-a-thons, and here we are with Dancing with the Stars. We've touched many lives through our healing meetings and cooking classes, and we've helped educate people and inspire people and move them in the right direction to help them, again, live more fully.
You know, back when Linda got lupus in 1973, there really wasn't any support group or anybody else to talk with, or, you know, and what I can see with Lisa is she's got support group to help other people with autoimmune diseases, but she also works on nutrition to help people out, exercise, and support. And that's something that, you know, Linda never had anything like that because there was nobody for her to really talk to.
The first healing meeting that I attended, we went around the room and said our name and our diagnoses and why we were there. And if you don't think you can make a difference in this world, you can't. There, one person can make a difference. And I saw that at that healing meeting.
And going to that meeting, let me see that there's other people struggling with what I'm struggling with, and I'm not alone. But the huge thing was finally facing that, hey, I gotta accept this, I gotta take this with stride, and you know, all these other people are doing it, and they're so positive about it.
And so, because of this organization, giving back to the community, showing us how to live with this, not be beaten down by it, not be controlled by this disease, but be successfully living with it. And one time she wasn't living, she was just existing. But because of this program, she learned how to live.
We are here to empower patients. We want them to be their own advocates. We don't want them to sit back and be a victim. It's very important to take control of your life, and we can manage them and help them move forward and not just exist in this world. We're not meant to just exist. We're meant to live life and live life fully. All of this is done by the community involvement, and that's the most important part of having this foundation. The foundation exists in the Quad City area because of you. And we're making strides and we're changing lives. And it's so important to reach out to each individual, because a third of you out there in this audience today is dealing with some type of autoimmune illness, whether you know someone or you yourself is struggling right now. And we're here to help. Lift It With Lupus is helping autoimmune in this community, and we will further our mission and we will continue to reach lives. And it takes you, and that's all we need.
I just wanted to give you a little hint on where we are and kind of where we started and where we're going. And we are, you know, kind of joining together with nutrition, Dr. Shaw. I'm a patient of Dr. Shaw's, and I commend him for helping me as well. And I'm going to add to a little bit of that. So when I started, when you first saw some of those icky pictures, you know, I have been medicated most of all my disease journey. And to this date, I'm on one medicine, one. That's like huge for me. Excuse me, sorry. A year and a half ago, I was on CellCept. I was on Benlysta, which is a biologic for lupus. I was on lots of chemotherapies. I was on Plaquenil, which is kind of a staple. I was on steroids, of course, always. And to date, I'm on LDN, which I don't know if Dr. Shaw is talking about that today or not, but it's a low-dose naltrexone, which is something that any holistic doctor would agree with. And so it's a very safe medicine and very low dose. And so I'm very proud of that. And I wouldn't have gotten here with all of this to where I am today with the nutrition, the exercise, and the whole approach of the functional medicine. And so I'm very thankful of the journey. I'm thankful that I lived it. I wouldn't be able to do what I'm doing. All the symptoms, all the pain, all the struggles, I wouldn't be able to help people. So I'm very thankful to have lived it. I wouldn't want to go through it again necessarily, but I feel like I'm on the right track. And I may have bumps in the roads. I mean, I just got through with this race. It's a huge event, the biggest event that we have. And so I had a little flare, but I got through it. And I mean, this was Saturday and it's Wednesday and I'm here standing. And I have a lot of energy. So I'm doing very well, and I'm thankful for all the the people that are involved getting me to this point, and myself included. I'm going to give myself a pat on the back as well, because I have to be diligent as a patient. You have to be your own advocate. You have to believe in yourself, and you have to believe and have the hope and the courage and the strength to get to where you want to be. So thank you very much for listening to my story, and I think I'm going to introduce Dr. Shaw. Is that correct?
Okay. We are going to have Dr. Shaw up next on the platform, and this guy is, you know, a man of kind. I really had a great time getting to work with Dr. Shaw and be there at his clinic, working side by side and helping patients like Lisa to not be defined by a chronic ailment or illness. So I'd like to welcome Dr. Shaw to the panel.
Before I start, I would like to give another round of applause to Lisa and Lisa. So, briefly about myself, I'm board certified in internal medicine and started practicing functional medicine a couple of years ago. And now I've recently, the past few months, my focus is more towards gut health and autoimmune diseases, basically. Because to me, gut health and autoimmune diseases is one and same. They're not separate. Okay. So, autoimmune diseases, when everyday food like this, and can. What are autoimmune disorders? I think you guys probably have enough ideas. Basically, our immune system just goes haywire. It's an amazing system. At the same time, protecting us from trillions of pathogens and chemicals, and at the same time also letting the good things pass through without reacting to it. So it has a very difficult job to find out what stuff is bad for us and what stuff is good for us. And so it's a system which is working 24/7, never rests. And so the problem arises when we overwhelm this system. Human health is nothing but equilibrium. So a little bit of shift and you will get sick. Unhealthiness is just disequilibrium. So going forward, so when the body attacks itself, simple. When our immune system starts thinking that what it's seeing is not normal, it's abnormal. Even though it's normal, but it starts attacking you. That's when you develop autoimmune diseases. Who is most likely to develop autoimmune disease? So, as we said, approximately 20-25% of the population is susceptible to autoimmune diseases, but only 3-5% will actually develop autoimmune disease. And that's because these 20-25% of the people, they have genes for autoimmune diseases, but they need this kick to their immune system from environmentals. Stress or factors to make that gene start producing the abnormal proteins. Females are 7 to 9 times more likely to develop autoimmune disorders. But definitely there is also a hormonal factor there also. But there are also certain autoimmune diseases which are very much present in males but not in females. And example is ankylosing spondylitis, which is usually seen in males and not in females. It's autoimmune diseases mainly found in the West. The immigrants also take on the same incidence of the disease as a native or indigenous population. As you heard before, that the people in Okinawa, which had, and I'm going to emphasize the word, had the highest number of centurions and very healthy, 9200 or above, when those people moved over here, they started having the same incidents and started dying at a very early age. And now, even in Okinawa, people are developing the same diseases as the West because they're eating the same diet now, same fast foods, because they have a big American base over there and they have all the fast foods available. So the younger Okinawans are as sick as people in the Western society. Some of the risk factors of certain individuals who are predisposed to increased risk of developing autoimmune diseases. Stress, you know, we learned about that. Vitamin D deficiency is a huge factor. Vitamin D is not a vitamin, it's a hormone. And it acts like a hormone. So there have been multiple studies done showing that if you're deficient in vitamin, you are not only prone in developing autoimmune diseases, you're also highly likely and much more susceptible to develop cancers. And the most common cancers are breast cancer, colon cancer, prostate cancer, but I can bet you if they do studies, they'll also find that probably any kind of cancer will happen at a higher incidence and frequency if you're deficient in vitamin D. Over here, in Midwest, there is an epidemic of vitamin D deficiency. The range in lab is between 30 to 100. So you're 31, you're within range, you're fine. That's what the regular physician will say. But actually the optimal level of vitamin D is between 60 to 80. In order to have any benefit from vitamin D is that your level should be 60 to 80. And I see that level very, very, very infrequently. It's very rare to see this level. So most of my patients, especially patients on autoimmune disorder, they are on supplementation for my disease. Viruses, they have been studies making, especially Epstein-Barr virus, herpes virus, in causing autoimmune diseases. And there have been different mechanisms which have been proposed, how these viruses and bacteria can cause autoimmune diseases, and I'll touch on those later. Hormonal imbalances, again, as I mentioned, mostly females are likely to develop, so there are hormonal influences, but exactly what, we still don't know. Pesticides, herbicides, and other risk factors out there. Okay, there are multiple theories of the causes of autoimmune diseases. Hyperactive immune function, which has fallen off as the most likely, weakened immune function. Again, so basically our immune system is there. It's when it gets, again, overwhelmed. It's just like if you have been working for 36 hours without any sleep and you are asked to do something which you do on a daily basis, you will find it very difficult to do that task. You have been awake for 36 hours. You are tired as hell. same thing with our immune system. It's there, it's functioning, but it's overwhelmed. It has to filter each and every virus, bacteria, pathogen, chemicals, pesticides, hormones that are we are eating, that we are breathing, that we are drinking. So this immune system is already overwhelmed, and you put a little bit of more stress that it can take, it's going to go off. And we do this by basically poor nutrition. That's one thing which is in our hand. You know, many times the air we breathe, it's not, we can't do anything about it, except moving away from that area. But sometimes we don't even realize that we're living in such toxic environment. Like, example is Muscadine. If you drive from Quad Cities to Muscadine, as soon as you hit the sign, you will feel the difference in the air if you don't live in Muscadine. People who live in Muscadine, they don't feel the difference at all. But if you don't live there, as soon as you enter the city, you will feel it. It will be hard for you to breathe. That's a huge toxic load. So, but the most important is the food. Infectious agents, and I mentioned viruses, herpes virus, Epstein-Barr virus, the agent of infectious mononucleosis, they have been implicated in lupus. They have been the hepatitis C virus, in autoimmune hepatitis. The bacteria like Yersinia in autoimmune thyroid disorder. So there are different hundreds and hundreds of bacteria and viruses which have been implicated. Vaccines have been implicated in GB syndrome, Guillain-Barré syndrome. Chronic exposure to chemicals, allergens, antibiotics, pollutants, etc. Oxidative stress and autoimmunity is probably the most important, and it's usually probably the final result of many things. So our immune system uses what we call as free radicals to kill the bad guys. So free radical is nothing but reactive species which do not have an electron in their outer shell. So these molecules, what they do if they see a bacteria, they will take out an electron from their membrane. In doing so, they make that bacteria or virus or anything to be susceptible to be destroyed by our white cells or natural killer cells. Now, it's a double-edged sword, because when they take the radicals, they also create more radicals. And our immune system, if it keeps on producing these radicals, it gets overwhelmed. And these radicals cause something called oxidative damage. And that is the basis for almost any autoimmune disease that you can think of. So the inciting agent could be a virus, it could be a bacteria, it could be pollutant, chemicals, pesticides. But what it does, it causes this oxidative damage, and that leads to autoimmunity. Apoptosis is programmed cell death. Every day, a human body sheds off 10 billion cells. That's programmed cell death. We have to have apoptosis to live. If we didn't have apoptosis while we were being developed, we won't have fingers. So that's the reason this apoptosis is so important, because that is one of the the main reason behind having cancer. The cancer cells become rogue. They stop dying. They don't go through the natural apoptosis. Excitotoxins are some of the theories and the mostly MS people, the multiple sclerosis, excited boxes, glutamate, which is the major excitatory neurotransmitter in our brain. And it's good if we need it for concentration, focus, hearing. But if it's too much, it's going to cause excessive oxidative stress and will cause the lesions of MS, multiple sclerosis, and lead to the, and even Alzheimer's disease and Parkinson's disease because of this excessive levels of glutamate. And this excessive level of glutamate can occur because of multiple things, stroke, brain trauma. That's infectious agents and molecular mimicry. Bacteria and viruses are very smart, much, much smarter than human beings. They've been here on this planet way before us, and they will be here even when we are gone. And what they do is, what they have learned is, when they go in, they realize how the immune system recognizes them. So what they do, some of these, they try to disguise themselves as normal human proteins. So our immune system lets them go. But sometimes they're not able to really fool the immune system. So immune system recognizes them as foreign, but it gets confused that, okay, these, some molecule I know, some molecule I don't, what should I do? And sometimes it ends up attacking the virus and the same kind of tissue that the virus is mimicking. And that's also one of the theories behind the causes of autoimmune diseases. And again, it's all point towards one thing. If your immune system is rested and healthy, it will not make mistakes. If your immune system is tired and overwhelmed, it's like us, we're going to make mistakes. We're going to crash our car while we are driving after being awake for 36 hours. Allergies and cytokines. Cytokines are just chemical messengers which our immune system use, and other theories. Okay. So low-dose naltrexone, as Lisa was saying, both of them. This was developed in the 1970s to treat heroin addiction, but it was used in very high doses, around 100 to 300 milligrams a day, used in heroin addiction and also in alcohol addiction. So this is not natural, it's synthetic. In 1980, Dr. Bernard Bihari was the first one to use it in patients with HIV infection and other autoimmune diseases. What he found was that the patients that he was using this naltrexone, because most of the HIV infected people were addicted to heroin, that they were developing less HIV associated cancers and other autoimmune diseases, which are very, very common in HIV patients. And so he started experimenting on seeing that which patient responded the best. And he kept on decreasing the dose. And then he got to the lowest dose, and he found out that those patients responded the best. So how does low-dose naltrexone work? It affects cell growth, basically. So when you give low-dose naltrexone, if you give high-dose naltrexone, so what naltrexone is, a opiate antagonist. All of our cells in our body have opiate receptors. These opiate receptors are involved in multiple things, from controlling our inflammation, from controlling our immune system. When you use high-dose naltrexone, it blocks these opiate receptors for 24 hours or more. So in that way, when you block it for a long period of time, it causes the cell growth actually to get faster, to exceed. And when you use it for a short period of time, or a lower dose, sorry, it attaches to the receptor only for 4 to 6 hours and then goes away. It's metabolized. So during that 4 to 6 hours, our body thinks that it needs the opioid hormones that we produce naturally, the happy hormones, which we call endorphins or metenchephalin. So during that time, our body starts producing a lot of endorphins and metenchephalins. These endorphins and metenchephalins are the primary modulators which affect the cell growth. So after 4 to 6 hours, the low dose naltrexone is gone and your body is left with immense amount of these endorphins and metenchephalins. And these endorphins, as I mentioned before, the glutamate, the excitotoxin, they cause this glutamate reduction by reducing nitric oxide synthase, which is sort of like a vehicle which carries this glutamate away from the neuron. So in people with autoimmune diseases, you need the cells to be controlled and not to grow excessively out of control. And that's how low-dose naltrexone works. In people with wounds, you need excessive cell growth to cure that wound. So in those people, we use high-dose naltrexone as a cream that's applied locally. But in people with autoimmune diseases and cancers, low-dose naltrexone is used in order to increase the body's own production of metenchephalin and endorphins. And that's why when I keep patients on low-dose naltrexone, I tell them that if you have to go through surgery, scheduled surgery, you have to stop the low-dose naltrexone 5 to 7 days before, because it blocks the opioid receptors and your pain medicines will not work properly. So that's the only thing that we have to be aware of, the low-dose naltrexone. So the low-dose naltrexone has successes with other autoimmune disorders, lupus, MS, Parkinson's, Alzheimer's, ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis. I use it in people with irritable bowel syndrome also, cancer, and autism spectrum disorders. So, and again, it's not going to work for everybody. It will work for some people, it will not work for some people, but the beauty of this medicine is that it has a very low side effect profile. Mostly it affects sleep, and it can cause either the person to go have be more sleepy or have some problems falling asleep. But again, these effects only last for 1 to 2 weeks, and usually your body gets used to it. So that's why it's always, to me, as a functional medical provider, it's always worthwhile to give it a trial because of it's such a beautiful safety profile that it has. As I said, my focus is on gut. So in addition to using low-dose naltrexone for autoimmune diseases, I also focus on gut health. As everybody's they're talking about nutrition and how basically, we are trying to control inflammation. Inflammation is the main thing which is making your immune system overwork. So it's the basis for everything. Lung diseases, cancers, heart disease, Alzheimer's, diabetes, arthritis, autoimmune diseases, neurological diseases, everything is, the base is inflammation, and inflammation starts from your gut. So this is just a quick slide, what happens when you take antibiotics, bad food, bad drink, germs, stress. So our intestinal lining is only one cell thick, only one cell. And so, and there's a very delicate balance which is keeping that one cell thick lining there. This lining is doing so many things at one time. It's producing enzymes to help with digestion. It's allowing the good particles to go through. It's disallowing the bad particles. It's keeping the bacteria to enter into the bloodstream. So you can just imagine how much work this one cell thick lining is doing. So when we do all these things, it goes into imbalance, or which we call dysbiosis. And when that happens, those things which should not go into our bloodstream gain access to our bloodstream. And our immune system, 75% of our immune system is in and around our gut. And there's a reason why it's there. Because that's where all the problem starts. And so this excessive load then gets too much for our immune system. And that's when you start having all the problems. I try to tell the patients, think of your skin and your gut inside as one surface. If you think it's one surface. Essentially, our gut, from our mouth down to our anus, is a tube which is outside of our body. Our proper body is actually around that tube. So that's why our immune system is mostly located, and that's why the gut is so important. So, to put it simply, low-dose naltrexone is believed to restore homeostasis by invoking changes in the immune function. Low-dose naltrexone helps the body heal itself. So it uses your own body, your own body's hormones to heal you. That's why it has such low side effect profile. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Shaw. Appreciate that. That is going to conclude it as far as our speakers, but I do want to do about a 5-minute panel. I don't know if there's any questions that anyone has out there, but I'd like to bring both Lisa's up here and stand with Dr. Shaw and I and address any questions that there may be in the audience tonight.
I have a question. Do you treat cancer patients then?
Yes, because essentially what we're trying to do is trying to reduce inflammation, reduce the cancer. Also happens when your immune system starts.
Stage four,
well, with stage four, I always say, when traditional medicine has told you, that's it, we don't have anything else for you. So even if you have doubts about functional medicine, what's there to lose?
Apoptosis stage. We talk about the apoptosis stage, and with that slide. But anyway, the death stage of the cell.
Mm-hmm.
And so that happens in autoimmune as well. Like we don't understand. Our bodies don't get how to reach that apoptosis stage in some instances. Is that correct?
Yes. So apoptosis is basically controlled by the mitochondria. Mitochondria are the factories in our cells. They are the part of the cells which produce energy. It's not the nucleus, it's the mitochondria. Mitochondria, we get our mitochondrial DNA or mitochondria from our mothers. And mitochondrial DNA is totally different in appearance and shape and structure than any of the cells in our body. You must have heard about the term ATP. Which is the energy form that the body uses, that's produced in the mitochondria. Mitochondria, being so important, are the most sensitive part of the cell to inflammation.
Okay.
any oxidative stress, like, you know, if you have too much inflammation, we go down on our natural antioxidants, glutathione. And mitochondria are the first organelles to really feel the sting of that inflammation. And mitochondria control apoptosis. So when you have excessive inflammation, the mitochondria are affected, and when they are affected, apoptosis gets affected. And the programmed cell death gets affected. And autoimmune disease, we have cancer.
And then ibuprofen, can you take like NSAIDs with the LVM?
Yes, you can. The but I always say that these medications, the NSAIDs, ibuprofen, Aleve, Tylenol, should be taken very sparingly. You know, because NSAIDs cause direct damage to the intestinal lining cells. They also are very toxic to the kidneys. Obviously, we all know that they cause gastritis and ulcers. Tylenol is not a benign drug at all. Very damaging to the liver. So in the hospital, you know, I've worked, and now we also have intravenous Tylenol, only in the hospitals. And it's very good medicine if it's used properly. So I was working in a hospital, and the surgeons have this protocol. Now we have EMR, so you click and the whole set comes down. And the surgeons were clicking intravenous Tylenol every 6 hours for a patient post-operatively, and they were forgetting to put in a stop date. And I did complain that this is going to harm a patient. And so I was consulted on a patient who was post-operative, fourth day post-operative, with acute hepatic liver failure. Came for knee replacement and had to be transferred to University of Iowa for liver failure, just because the Tylenol was going every 6 hours. So these medicines for just for acute pain, once in a while it's okay, but you have to be really careful with taking them on a regular basis. So, you know, if you had a headache, some kind of joint pain or fever once in a while, you know, you can take it. The guidelines say that, like, ibuprofen should not be 800 milligrams, three times a day is the max limit. And acetaminophen used to be 4 grams a day, now it's 3 grams, which is two extra strength tablets every 8 hours as needed. But if you take it regularly, it is going to make you really sick and potentially deadly. Questions?
Are insurance companies on board with functional medicine?
That's a tricky question. Because I'm an internist, so I do accept insurances for the visit. Many of the tests that I use, most of the insurances do cover those tests partially, or sometimes 80%, I would say, but not all the insurance, but most of the big insurances. But the management, because we go towards more nutrition, supplementation specific, that's not covered by insurance. Like the low-dose naltrexone, it's not covered by insurance, but it's not an expensive medication. But in order to heal the gut, the therapies that I use, that's not covered by insurance.
Okay. No more questions?
Thank you so much. Thank you for coming.